my nerd world.
Where's the revolution?
Depeche Mode has, well, been touring the United States. Welcome to episode 22 of the Modecast. I am your host, Jon Justice. Let's get right to it. Miami New Times has an article. This was out on, it came out today. Let me read to you from this, and then we'll dive into the show, and I'll tell you what we have planned for this podcast. The Miami New Times article goes like this. And the headline really caught my attention. Depeche Mode brought sex and cigarettes to the AAA. This is the American Airlines Arena. Sex and cigarettes. Now, I'm really, like, first I was annoyed, and then I was really glad that they mentioned this. Okay, so let me read you what they wrote. And this is Zach Schellen of the Miami New Times. For one night, the American Airlines Arena reeked of cigarettes. Walking to the arena from US 1, you could see their handlers milling about the balcony. Like eyeliner-clad gargoyles spilling smoke and ashes from their open mouths. The occasion for such a morbid gathering, Depeche Mode's Miami stop on their Global Spirit Tour, was a throwback in more ways than one. Beyond the staggering reality that Depeche Mode is now a legacy act, the halls of AAA were littered with black shirts. Seriously, it was near unison, emblazoned with beloved acts of years past. The Nine Inch Nails logo, the omnipresent cover of Unknown Pleasures, and some reference to the Smiths and or Morrissey proving to be particularly popular. There was also, of course, the unmistakable hint of burnt processed tobacco long ago banished from indoor venues. Although the air was thick with nostalgia, Depeche Mode themselves were as urgent as ever, performing a career-spanning set with enough selections across their discography to satiate all but the pickiest of fans. Dave Gahan, Martin Gore, and crew put on a show for the ages, running through a monstrous 22-song set over the course of 2.5 hours. Depeche Mode reminded Miami just where the name for city's premier electronic music festival comes from and why. So there's more to this particular interview, but it just breaks down basically the details of the show, saying losing little of his sex appeal in the intervening 36 years between Speak and Spell and last night, Gahan brazenly sashayed, stomped, and strutted his slender frame through the duration of the evening, owning tracks like the Violator standout World to My Eyes, as well as introducing some much-needed sleaze and relative subtlety to AAA, American Airlines Arena. All right, so I was a little bit annoyed at first because it seemed like a bizarre thing to go and pick up on, this cigarette part of it, right? Long since cast, cigarettes, you know, okay, cast off, you don't smoke anymore around there, okay? But there's something to that. And what I mean by that is for older fans like myself, I'm 45 years old, there is a nostalgia factor to Depeche Mode, a huge nostalgia factor. And as a matter of fact, the last 15 minutes of the podcast, and I'll explain this a little bit more in a moment, the last 15 minutes of the podcast is 15 minutes that I recorded several weeks ago while I was out on a bike ride. I didn't want to, it was going to be a whole show, but I didn't want to subject you to, 45 minutes of me riding my bike and the poor audio quality. But I really liked what I had recorded. There was something organic about it. I know it sounds weird. I was on my bike. I was listening to Depeche. You'll hear what I talk about. But I really wanted to record, and I just recorded right off of my earbud mic 15 minutes of me talking about the era of Violator and how much of my Depeche Mode fandom was solidified during that era. That era was an era of Smiths and Morrissey t-shirts and Joy Division and Nine Inch Nails and black t-shirts and, yeah, cigarette smoke. I used to smoke. I quit the day that my wife told me that she was pregnant with our now 15-year-old. I quit cold turkey and maybe I've had one or two since then on occasion. I couldn't tell you the last time it was. It wasn't like, but I quit cold turkey. I don't think I ever bought an actual pack of cigarettes after that. But there's a nostalgia to that. I mean, you could smoke back then, and when you went out to nightclubs, and when you went to Depeche Mode concerts, especially when you went to as many as, what, 30, 32, 36, I can't remember, I'm in the 30s, of the times you've seen them live, you know, the Depeche Mode, you know, brought sex and cigarettes to the American Airlines arena. Zach, the writer in this New Times article, wasn't trying to key in. He did a little bit. I think he was more annoyed that they were smoking, but the truth is, no, that is nostalgic. It does harken back to a different era. I've talked about this several times on previous podcasts, and there is a level when new material comes out that you want to be able to recapture some of that nostalgia, that feeling that you had, you know, back when we all became fans of this band. And Spirit has done that. I had a really interesting experience again with Spirit, and I know I'm avoiding the obvious question as to why I haven't done a podcast in a long time. I'm getting to it for those that are long time. I say long time listeners. It's only episode number 22, but I know that I've gone AWOL for a while, and I explained a little bit why in a previous podcast. But for those that are wondering, John, why haven't you mentioned why you haven't done a podcast in a long time? I'll get to it here in just a moment. But I had an interesting experience the other day because I've been really. I usually listen to music based off of mood, and Spirit's a different album where, you know, there's such a, I love the album, and it has a very distinct flavor, and there's already kind of a memory attached to it like most Depeche Mode releases have for me, but I hadn't really been in the mood to be listening to anything that was, you know, anything relating to the lyrical content of majority of the album. I've been listening to parts of the album. So, you know, the parts of the album that I've been listening to has been, you know, Poison Heart. I listened to that song a ton. Cover Me. I listened to that song a ton. No More This Is the Last Time. I listened to that song a ton. But I hadn't really listened to the album top to bottom in a while. And I had a really, really good day last week. It was just one of those days where just everything just clicked. And I'm heading to New York on Wednesday next week, depending on when you listen to this. So this will be Wednesday the 21st. And for those that are interested, if you are stateside and you want to see this particular Depeche Mode fan on TV, I will be live on a show called SE Cup Unfiltered on the HLN network. Used to be Headline News. They just call it HLN now. It is a spinoff of CNN, and they're beginning to branch out their programming. I'm a news talk radio show host Monday through Friday. That's my regular job here in Minneapolis. But the woman who hosts that show, SC Cup, is a political commentator and is a CNN commentator, and we're really good friends. And she now has her own show, where they don't just talk about politics, but they talk about the world we live in life in general and all kinds of different issues, not just the news of the day, but pop culture stuff, family stuff, music stuff, movie stuff. She's flying me out on Wednesday, and I'm going to be on her show on Wednesday night and Thursday night. So if you want to check it out and see me on TV, I doubt I'll be able to talk any Depeche Mode, but that's where you can definitely go and find me. But by the way, it'll be on at 7 o'clock Eastern on HLN every night. But again, the 20th and 21st is when I'll be on that particular program. So how does this relate to Depeche Mode? Well, the producers of the show reached out to me on this particular day Thursday and asked if I could come and if I could go on the show via remote. So when you watch, if you watch any of the mainstream media news and they have guests on there that are live in another location, that's what I did. So I went to downtown Minneapolis and got into a studio and did about 7 segments on her show last week. So when I was having a great day and then they asked me to come on the show and I was really excited about it. And so I was at a moment where I didn't have a care in the world. I just was like, man, this is a great day. I'm going to listen to Spirit. And I put it on top to bottom, and it was great. It was just one of those moments where even sitting in traffic, I was glad that I was actually – I left super early to get there on time and ended up having to sit in downtown Minneapolis traffic and was more than happy to while I listened to this fantastic record. The only thing that bummed me out was the fact that I still am not lined up to go see this tour live, and I don't even want to talk about it. But it was just a great moment. I will say that there is a part of me that wishes that the album didn't have sort of lyrical wise. I wish it was a little bit less on the nose. I like it. Don't get me wrong. I mean, I love the album. I do love the album a lot. And I really think it's a return to form for the band. And hopefully over time, I can treat a lot of the songs on the record the same way that I would a song like Everything Counts or, to a lesser extent, Master and Servant. But any of the songs that sort of also had that political landscape is changing, back from their, in their past catalog. And I won't be so hung up, because I get a little hung up now on the lyrical content of some of the songs in it. I don't enjoy it nearly as much. That's also a bit of a byproduct of the fact that I'm a news talk host. And, I need to get away from politics every once in a while. And so, I don't want to, I love going backwards and I love Where's the Revolution, but I'm like, I don't really want to hear those songs right now. So all that is to say, let's get to the next part of the show, shall we? So here's what we got. I got an email here that I want to share with you. Want to talk a little bit, and we'll do this first, a little bit about the release of Cover Me, the video, and the remixes, which I have not had a chance to hear yet. I don't think they're available. At least they weren't available when I checked before the show. And then I'll play you this 15 minutes. It's sort of a mini modecast in the middle of the modecast, because I actually kind of intro it like it's the modecast. It's dated. I talk about the band coming to America, and obviously they weren't here yet. So the audio quality's crap. My apologies up front. So first off, Cover Me. They released the video for Cover Me, and they did kind of what I thought they were going to do. And I'm surprised they haven't done this before, but they basically used Anton Corbin's screen footage shot for the Global Spirit Tour and made it the video. And I kind of wish they would do that for all the songs. Maybe not going backwards, but I'd love to see the So Much Love, screens turned into a video. I think that would be fantastic. But they did. They just took the transfer of the footage that Anton created of Dave Gahn in the space suit walking through the streets of L.A. I believe it's Venice Beach, and sitting on the park bench, and then up in the space capsule, all in black and white, very Anton Corbin. And I dig it. It's cool. Dave looks old. Not gonna lie. Had a couple people comment that the years have not been kind to Dave. But the reality is, Dave wasn't kind to Dave. So I wish he'd shave. It's so stupid. I know, but I know he's fit and he's thin, but that with his scruff makes him look older. But I'm just glad he's here. I'm just glad the band's still making music. The guy, let's be honest, the guy should have been dead. I lived through that period. I remember when the reports came over on K-Rock in Los Angeles that, Dave Gahn of Depeche Mode had, done a drug overdose. I've been to that hotel where that drug overdose took place. I remember what he looked like. He was almost one of those rock stars that went out in a blaze of glory. So yeah, he looks old, but you know what? He's kicking, he's healthy, and I'm happy about it. But I do like the video. I saw some comments of people that were comparing it to the simplicity of the Enjoy the Silence video, and I absolutely agree. It's a great little piece of art. And just like the Enjoy the Silence video is, it's the first video in a long time that I'll probably go back and watch quite a bit. I have a list of, I call it my drunk list. I don't really get that drunk, but on Fridays and Saturday nights, I have my wine. So I have a list of things that I like to go and watch, towards the end of the evening, because I'm in a good mood, obviously, because I've drank a bottle of wine. Cover Me is going to end up on my, what I call my, jokingly, my drunk list. So I am looking forward to hearing the remixes. I really, really hope, one of these remixes is something akin to an extended remix. I know I've gotten emails from you in the past, talkshownerd@gmail.com. And I know there are several of you who have mentioned, that you also miss the sort of standard extended remixes of the songs. And I do too. So I'd love to get just a straight up extended remix. Don't need to change it up. Just give me more of it. Something akin to the one that I created back in one of the early Modecasts. Go back and check it out if you missed it. I made a sort of quasi remix of Cover Me, and I hope one of them is that. The other thing I'm hoping for in the remixes, and then I'm going to get to an email, and that is I'm hoping that maybe we get something similar to A Pain That I'm Used To. That version that they do now, they did it on the Delta Machine tour, and I believe they're doing it on this tour, right? Yeah. That up-tempo version, which was based off of a remix that was done of A Pain That I'm Used To. I dig that. It's cool. Those don't usually translate as well, but that one's cool. So if we got something similar to that with Cover Me, I'd be pretty pleased. So I'm really looking forward to hearing the remixes. Bummed out we haven't got any B-sides, and I haven't seen any word about getting any B-sides, but I'd really like to hear some of the tracks that didn't make the record. But again, there hasn't been, I haven't seen any news of that yet, and I have been keeping my eye out. So if I hear, of course, I will let you know. All right, got an email here to talkshownerd@gmail.com. This comes from Renee Lopez, and starts like this: "Blessings, John. I mean, I'm gonna wipe out on the first two things here. Blessings, John. I dig that. That's cool, right?" That doesn't mean if you email me, you need to start off with something different than hi, but I just like the blessings, John. That's just different and unique. So thank you, Renee. I've been a big listener of your Depeche Mode podcast and enjoyed them a lot. I have not seen an updated one in a while. What happened? All right. So what happened? I did a podcast a while back, and I mentioned that I was going to be taking a break, and I have taken a break. I've had a lot going on. I've needed to focus on my regular job, and I have this other project that I've been working on. And you know what? Not that it matters, not that you're going to care, okay? But you will be the first ones that I will tell apart from my wife, who is the only other person that knows that I'm doing this. So it can be our secret on the podcast, for as secret as that can be, but this is a very niche audience. I don't think that the rest of I know my dad listens to my NASCAR and my Star Wars podcasts. I don't think he listens to my Depeche Mode podcasts. So I feel like we have an intimate relationship. Okay. So, what have I been working on this project? I'm writing a book. It is a sci-fi book, and perhaps I'll give you some more details sometime down the road. It's something that I never thought I'd do, but I had this idea, and I've been sitting on it for a long time, and started writing basically a synopsis, and then coming up with characters, and then figured out a plot, and I've been writing this book, and I'm about are we close to halfway? Maybe three? No, not quite halfway yet. It's going to take me a while. I'm a horrible writer. And I don't mean horrible writer. I mean horrible, just my grammar is awful, right? Just my writing skills suck. So, and I write slow. But I had this idea. I've got it fleshed out. It is sci-fi based. Depeche Mode is included in it. So when it's done, hopefully... You know, those of you that maybe are into sci-fi, maybe are into, if you're into Star Wars, I hopefully you'll dig this. I'm trying to create something different and unique, a story that I like, things that I like about science fiction. I'm trying to bring into this. There's a romance involved. How can there not be? And yeah, Depeche Mode is involved. It's set in the future, and that's been the project that I've been working on. So it doesn't mean that I don't have time to do the show, the podcast, but I've had to really focus on what I'm going to work on and divide my time up accordingly. So that's why there hasn't been a show for a long, long time. I don't know what the consistency is going to be. Longtime listener of the show, Jon, J-O-H-N, Justice, had dropped me a tweet and was going to see Depeche Mode coming up in Nashville, I believe, on Monday, and was wanting a podcast to get into it. And honestly, he's the one that brought me out of semi-retirement. And I also thought about the fact that, you know, if I were going to one of the shows, I would love to have something to listen to after a concert. And that gave me a bit of an idea. And if I end up doing the shows on a consistent basis, I may try to do that. I may try to do something and target them to this particular tour to give people something to listen to after the show. We used to listen to like concert echoes. Radio stations used to always do the echo. K-Rock used to play the whole set list in its entirety, the original tracks. They would go and play them in their entirety. And I know that when we were able to get our hands on the playlist, I used to make the track list and create the track list so I can listen to the concert again on the drive home. So hopefully people will be able to use, well, and hopefully I hope that's right. See, I told you I was a horrible writer. It'd be really cool if people found the podcast while going to the shows, because there is kind of a timeless quality to a lot of the podcasts. And so, you know, with 22 episodes to choose from, it'd be sweet if people were able to find the show and listen to it after they go and see the tour. So, all right, there's just a lot more in Renee's email I got to get to, and then I got to play you this other portion here on my bike ride. So she goes on to say, love Depeche Mode, my favorite band of all time. I wanted to bring something up in regards to the tour and the song Wrong. I don't know if every DM fan knows that in the album, Sounds of the Universe, after Corrupt ends, if you leave dead air for a couple of minutes, you hear a cool instrumental of Wrong for about 10 seconds. Yeah, it's the middle portion of the original song. It's kind of a riff on that. My point is, this is the way the song starts out each show, and then the original version kicks in. I figured I would share this with the devoted DM fan. God willing, I'll be going to see them here in Miami. Oh, that's funny, because that's where the review was from. On the 15th with my wife. Sorry, Renee, you're a dude. My apologies. Thank you for that. I was actually thinking that when I said she, because I knew you can go Renee either way. I dated a Renee once, that's why. With my wife, who happens to be a huge fan as well. Been listening to them since the early 80s. I know that in the last podcast, you didn't care too much for the way Dave was moving on stage. Here is my take. We both have to feel blessed to have the privilege to have had the privilege to listen and watch this epic band for decades. This might be the last time we get to see them. And I agree, dude. I absolutely agree. I think Dave has matured and evolved in many ways. And I believe when in your mind, you're mid-50s, you're not necessarily going to do certain moves that you did prior. And he kind of slowed down a bit. I guess for me, I get more caught up in how amazing their songs are and how great the music is. That they make. I sure hope this isn't the end. This album was truly amazing, and I've listened to it endless amounts of times. I hope you have time to answer my email one day. I look forward to listening to your DM podcast soon. God bless you, and take care, Renee Lopez. So, again, my apologies for putting the wrong gender on your name, and God bless you too, man. I agree. I was just being honest about Dave and sort of his you know, sort of monkey dance. I'm with you, though. I've gone back and watched some of the concert footage since then and gotten used to it. I do miss the Dave of old, but he is now the old Dave, not the Dave of old. And I agree with you that man, it's just great they're making music. And they sound great. That's the thing, too. And I probably should have mentioned this a long time ago, but he sounds solid. That wasn't the case. I mean, there was a couple of tours. As a matter of fact, the Sounds of the Universe Blu-ray His singing's not good on that. It's very nasally. When he does In Chains and when he does Wrong, really, really, really nasally. And he's gotten away from that, and he's back to sounding... That was the one thing that I always appreciated about the band was the vocals were so spot on. I mean, so spot on. I'm not a big fan of listening to live music, but if you go and throw in Songs of Faith and Devotion, the live album, it's solid. It sounds really, really good, and it's beefy. And I've used that word a lot, and that's why I like Spirit so much. Spirit is beefy. It's just it's really, really beefed up. And so, you know, because of that, when you hear those live versions and the vocals are so spot on, it really just brings it up to a completely different a different level. So, yeah, I'm with you, and hopefully people didn't take offense to that. Again, I was being honest. I thought Dave's dancing was kind of goofy at the time, but again, he's not by any stretch the Dave that he used to be, right? Okay, so let's get to the portion of the podcast that I had recorded out on my ride. So again, this was spur of the moment. This probably was the week after episode number 21 of the show. And I go for these daily bike rides too, and that kind of plays into when I'm gonna time out. When I do the shows. Speaking of that, just real quick, a song that popped up on my playlist recently that took on a lot of new meaning for me. A Question of Time. Subject matter wise. The bit of the kink with the young girl, only 15. We'll just ignore that for the moment. But, you know, as we get older, and to Renee's email, and Dave gets older, you know, time comes into play in a way that it never did before. And it's not like, I mean, I've got a long time left, you know, provided my heart doesn't give way at some point. But I like to think that I've got a long life ahead of me. But When you're married and you got kids and you've got a job and you have these other projects you work on, whether it's the other podcasts that I do, whether it's this book that I'm writing, you know, time is of the essence. And so I have to economize my time. And a part of that is building in time for me as well and making sure that I do the things, because I'm very much a creature of habit. So that's another lame excuse as to why there hasn't been a show in a long, long time. But thanks to John. And thanks to Renee and the other people that have emailed, who I won't get to your emails today, but I appreciate the fact that people are reaching out going, hey, where's the show? So again, but A Question of Time, listening to that again, just took on a new meaning, a brand new meaning for me. You know, it's A Question of Time. And when I listened to it, I went, man, that song's just got new life. Oh, hey, look what I did there. All right. So let's get to it. It's about 15 minutes of me. You can go on a bike ride with me, take a ride with your podcast best friend while I talk Depeche Mode, and I get a little nostalgic in the process. My apologies for the audio quality, but I hope you enjoy it, and I'll be back on the backside to close the podcast out.
Well, it's Jon Justice. Welcome to my nerd world and Depeche Mode. The Modecast, the Pest Mode, the podcast. I'm glad you're with the show again this week. So, things sound different. That's for a very specific reason, because I'm actually out on my daily bike ride, in which case you're probably going to get a big batch of wind right now because I'm going down a hill. So, there's a park located just a mile or so from my house, and it's just got all these trails, and I've talked about this on a previous podcast, but you get into this forest part of the park, and I'm actually going through it right now. And if you're a Star Wars fan, like I am, imagine the speeder bike chase on Endor in Return of the Jedi. I mean, that's what it's like with these trails, and you can just go ripping through here. And it's just beautiful. I mean, the sun's out right now. It's like 72 degrees. The trees are casting shadows on the pavement in front of me, and often when I'm on my rides, I'm listening to Depeche Mode and conjuring up, you know, ideas for videos in my head and listening to the new album. And so I had intended on doing a show this week, and I thought, you know what, let me try something different and talk for a few minutes about Depeche Mode and do the show from my bike this week. So if you're willing to bear with me, we can discuss a little bit of Depeche Mode. Not any news right now. I mean, the band's obviously taking a break before the North American tour starts here in just a few weeks after the successful European leg. Really excited to see what the band has to offer stateside. Talked about it on last week's show, wanting to know if whether or not the playlist is going to change up at all. Probably not. You know, this. I can't imagine, and again, I've talked about this before, but I can't imagine a tour where things changed up all that much. Usually they shrink the tour down for the North American shows. Crowds are a little smaller. Venues are a little bit smaller. Going backwards, the single dropped. And I know there's some remixes available. They're not available to purchase yet, at least not when I checked this morning on iTunes, unless they're available in a different location. So when it comes to news about the band, there really isn't a lot right now. And the one thing I wanted to talk about, and just take a few minutes on the show today, it'd be a bit of a short show, but this is the topic that I had picked for this week. Obviously, I don't have any of your emails up in front of me. I'll save those for the next show. But the one thing I wanted to talk about was my favorite time of Depeche Mode. I wanted to talk about the time that when my experience with the band, my fandom of the band, the most memorable time for me. And it was everything surrounding the Violator era. From the release of the first single, from hearing Personal Jesus for the first time, hearing, Enjoy the Silence for the first time. The friends in my life in that moment, seeing the band live, the Los Angeles incident at the Warehouse Records back in the early 90s, for those that remember, when the band got mobbed at that record store doing a signing, and that was kind of the precursor to the famous World Violation Dodger Stadium shows. I was at both of those shows. Still have a flyer, basically a mini poster for that. I had it framed for the longest time, but it's kind of gotten shuffled in the mix with some moves that have taken place over the years. But that whole time frame of Violator, the World Violation Tour, that whole year, year and a half, probably close to 2 years, is probably my most memorable and special. It cemented my fandom of the band, my relationship with the band. I mean, I was already really, really into them. Having gotten really into music for the masses, was at a young age, early 20s, desperate to hear more music, gone to the Rose Bowl show, couldn't wait to hear what we were going to get. And, you know, stylistically, the band was really coming into its own. I mean, for better or worse, regardless of how you feel about Anton Corbin and his video work, he really did craft the visuals of this band. And their style was very unique. Dave's style was very unique. Stage presence, all the visuals, all the photographs, the videos were all very uniform. It started with Music for the Masses, but it really came into its own with Vital. The video release of Strange 2, right? Because you had Strange, the video release attached to Music for the Masses, and then Strange 2. And the fact that it was color. I remember, Music for the Masses had so much black and white attached to it with the videos. And you get to Violator, same style, still Anton Corbin, still that artsy graininess, but it had color to it. And even the cover for Strange 2 with the drive-in and the sign on the outside of the drive-in, Strange Get Ooh, because the letters were in the wrong spot, and the blue that washed over it. It's just amazing. All of it. I mean, anytime I see the Rose, the album cover, the cover for that video, I mean, all of it just, it's instant, instant memories pop up in my mind. And leading up to when we first got new material, it was around that time, really early internet, way early internet. I didn't have a computer at home. I borrowed my dad's, but a lot of that was still not all that accessible. But we'd heard rumors, you know, through K-Rock, living in L.A. in Orange County, California, listening to Richard Blade, that being sort of the band's, you know, the band's radio station, knowing they were working on a new album. So we knew they had been in the studio, and they were going to release something soon. And so you listened, you know, to the radio, waiting to hear something new get released. That's how you heard it for the first time. You didn't get a warning on the internet. You didn't get a letter. You didn't get an email. I didn't have that yet. You didn't get an alert, no notification. You just basically listened to the radio 24/7 and waited for the song to drop. And the routine was usually that K-Rock would let you know, we've got a debut from a huge band coming up on Thursday at 5 o'clock. Got to be listening. And I'll never forget that it was right around the time of Violator when they were going to drop this new music, this new song from this new band. And it wasn't Depeche Mode. And I was so utterly devastated. That actually happened twice to me. And I had to go and look at the dates, but I'm pretty sure it was Violator. When I think about the place where I was living at the time when this happened, I'm pretty sure it was Violator, because they ended up playing Give It Away Now by the Red Hot Chili Peppers instead of Depeche Mode. And they didn't say it was going to be Depeche Mode. Don't misunderstand. It was just that they said they were going to debut a new song. I assumed it was going to be Depeche Mode first. How big is they arriving in? And it turned out to be the Red Hot Chili Peppers. And it also happened once with Bjork and Army of Me. And that might have been attached to Songs of Faith and Devotion. Although when I first heard anything off of Songs of Faith and Devotion, it was when it was actually a tape, a demo that got through somebody else. But I'll save that story for another time. But I remember the first time that I heard Personal Jesus. I had actually heard the acoustic version. That's what got... I don't know if it's what got released first. I don't know if it's what I got my hands on. I want to say they played that first. And I remember just being shocked. You know what I mean? And that was a time, and it's not unlike now, but that's a time where us hardcore fans, you know, you and me, you're willing to give a new Depeche Mode song, at least I am, the benefit of the doubt. When I first heard Heaven, was really looking forward to hearing it and tried really hard to love that song. And I just don't. I thought it was a good song, but I thought it was a wasted opportunity. The fact that it just didn't go anywhere, it didn't have, what, that middle third, right, breakdown. I just really felt that it was just a complete and total, you know, wasted opportunity. So, but when I first heard Personal Jesus, I was blown away. I thought the acoustic version, I was like, wow, this is really cool. This is, you know, so different. This is so incredibly, you know, unique. And I remember listening to it. Sorry, I'm avoiding a car backing out of the driveway. I remember listening to it over and over again. And then one night, I remember K-Rock playing, living in Santa Ana, California, playing the full version of Personal Jesus. And it just blowing my mind. I had spent so much time listening to the acoustic version of that song that when I heard the fully produced mix with headphones on and the sounds just bouncing around from ear to ear, I remember I was absolutely just stunned at what I was hearing. It was so utterly amazing. Here's this song that I already loved on a stripped down complete version. And here's this fully produced, took everything about the song that I loved and just completely shot it to the next level. It was unbelievable. It's one of those moments that I will absolutely, you know, never ever forget. And at the time, you know, I remember even with Music for the Masses, you know, the idea that the band was going to be in town and I wouldn't have an opportunity to see them was just unfathomable. I mean, even with the Rose Bowl show, I remember going to the Rose Bowl thinking, man, if I couldn't be here, I don't know what I'd do. I don't know what I'd do if I'd be, you know, at home this close with the band nearby. And when the band did the warehouse appearance where the riot started in West Hollywood, I couldn't go. I had a buddy of mine went, and it's funny, if you watch the documentary on the remastered disc, you can actually see him on the documentary as they're showing them the TV footage, and you can see the crowd. There's a camera, there's a pan shot, and there's my buddy with sort of this longer, sort of male, almost bob haircut, holding a poster of the band as they move past the crowd waiting in line. And I remember how devastated I was that night that I couldn't be down there to go to this record signing for the band. Now, in retrospect, it's totally okay that I wasn't, based off the fact that, you know, turns out that I wouldn't have been able to see anything anyways, since only a handful of people got in and got their stuff signed before the windows almost caved in and the riot almost started. But I just remember that day so, so vividly, about thinking about the band being so close to where I was and me not being able to be there and see them. And it's funny because that really carried over to when the tour started, because I was bent on making sure that I got every ticket to every concert that I could. And sure enough, I mean, I went to, oh gosh, I went to both. I had to go back and look at my list when I get home. But I remember that I went to both shows at Dodger Stadium. There were just two, right? I had to go back and look. I know there were two. Might have been three. But I remember I went to both shows at Dodger Stadium. I remember I saw them at the Universal Amphitheater. And then I know that I saw them in San Diego on that tour. Just an absolutely amazing tour. And I'll get to more of that. I want to talk a little bit more about the tour and that time, because there's a lot of really fun sort of my story going to those concerts, what we did before those shows that I definitely want to get into. And getting the album for the first time, I mean, this was pre-CD. Everything was still on cassette. And it was an almost, oh gosh, I don't want to say religious, I don't want to go that route, but it was almost magical. It was a magical moment getting the first copy, you know, of Violator. Still is, any copy of any album. But just that magical moment where you get it in your hands, and you know that in your hands contains something that is so special to you, that you find so incredibly meaningful and precious. And if you haven't heard all the songs yet, right, certainly that was the case back then, if you hadn't heard all the songs yet, you just know that you were in for something special, a really rare treat in what you were about to listen to. You didn't know what discoveries, you know, were awaiting for you once you were able to take that cassette, put it in your player, and put your headphones on. So I'm going to stop this portion of the podcast here, and I will pick it up back in my studio. So we'll be right back.
And we are right back, and I'm out of time. We'll talk a little Violator next time I have a chance to sit down behind the mic. Thank you so much for downloading the podcast. Thank you for your listening, for your emails, talkshownerd@gmail.com. If you're going to the shows, I hope you have a fantastic time. I will be there with you in spirit. Still hope I get a chance to go see one of these shows live, but we'll see what happens. But thanks again for checking out the show, and I'll talk to you again real soon. Bye.